Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. He is the Son of God. Jesus died on the cross for my sins and the sins of the whole world. He was buried in a tomb, and on the third day he rose from the dead. I believe the story of Jesus' death and resurrection is the most important story in the history of the world. If you agree, you need to get the untold story. There are hidden secrets regarding the resurrection concealed in the original Greek. This is not some secret code. It is the plain and simple account of the resurrection as it appears in the original Greek. Centuries ago, the resurrection account was changed, and most of the translators have repeated a lie rather than translate the original account as it appears in the Greek. When a person testifies in court, they place their hand on the Bible and state, "I swear that the testimony that I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God." When it comes to God's Word, I want the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Isn't that what you want? Is there anyone who truly wants a lie? If you want the whole truth and nothing but the truth, you need to watch this video. The whole truth comes from the original Greek resurrection accounts in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Most Christian leaders agree that the Word of God is perfect as it was written in its original language of Hebrew and Greek. Anything added to the original or changed from its original is a lie. I bet your pastor has referred back to the original Greek and Hebrew in his sermons at one time or another. He most likely indicated that some things are much more clear in the original language. Is it possible that the English Bible translations we read are not providing the full original resurrection story? Is it possible that centuries ago the resurrection account was changed and these changes appear in our English Bibles? The sad and hard truth is yes. The secret regarding the resurrection, which has been hidden from you, is simple but profound. This secret is very significant in shaping what you believe and how you worship. This secret is shocking. You might feel dazed when you learn it. Jack Nicholson is famous for the line, "You can't handle the truth." I think you can handle the truth, and I think you want it. And that's why you need to watch this full video. There is a simple and explainable reason why the original resurrection account was changed. Satan doesn't want you to know the truth. When Satan can't conceal the truth, he will distort it. I am confident that hundreds and even thousands of church leaders over the centuries have known about this secret and have kept silent. This includes many of our church leaders today. I don't claim any intellectual ability to find hidden truth in God's Word. My secret is prayer. Whenever I study God's Word, I pray, and I am totally dependent on the Holy Spirit to lead me, guide me, and give me understanding. I only care about truth. Tradition means nothing. God revealed this secret to me while I was in prayer, and I confirmed it in His Word. Before I reveal this secret, we need to agree on something simple, and that is what a word is. A word is used to communicate either orally or in written form. There are some words that have different meanings, but the meaning can be determined by the context in which the word is used. If a word has random meanings that cannot be determined by its context, it is not a word, it has no value, and cannot be used to to communicate any meaningful information. I must advise you, I don't want, and I am not asking you to take my word on this. You should find this resurrection secret both surprising and very difficult to believe. Not only should you find it difficult to believe, but you should simply refuse to believe it until clear and convincing evidence is provided to prove what I'm going to reveal. This is exactly what I have done. First, I will reveal the secret. Then, I will give you the original Greek and give you its literal meaning. Second, I'll give you the gospel accounts from an English Bible that has translated the original Greek accurately. Lastly, I will show how all the biblical accounts regarding Jesus' trial, death, burial, and the events between his burial and resurrection all support my conclusions. I ask you to follow along in your Bible and concordance. If you don't have a concordance, online versions are available. If you prefer, you can watch the video and then download the study and go over it at your own pace. Now, as I reveal this secret, please accept it for what it is, new light from God's holy word. The original Greek says Jesus rose from the dead on the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, not on Sunday. All four original Greek resurrection accounts state that Jesus rose from the dead on Miaton Sabbaton, which literally means one of the Sabbaths. Sabbaton is Strong's number G4521. According to Strong's, Sabbaton occurs 68 times in the New Testament. 59 times, 86% of all occurrences, it is translated correctly as Sabbath or Sabbath day. 9 times, it is translated incorrectly as week. Remember what we discussed earlier. If a word has random meanings that cannot be determined by its context, it is not a word. It has no value and cannot be used to communicate any meaningful information. Sabbaton has a defined meaning. It means Sabbath. This is what Sabbaton looks like written in Greek. If you put this in Google Translate, there are no surprises. Google says Sabbaton means Sabbath. If Jesus had actually risen from the dead on Sunday, the gospel writers had several options to make that abundantly clear. Please excuse my pronunciation. They could have just simply written Sunday, which in Greek is Kyrios, or first day of the week. There are two options for that in Greek, proton, mera, kuklo, ho, abdomada, or protos, mera, kuklo, ho, abdomada. Abdomada equals week, mera equals day, and proton or protos equals first. So how do the translators justify first day of the week from miaton sabbaton? Mia literally means one, but the translators translated mia as first rather than one. Then they added the word day, which never occurred in the original Greek text. And they translated sabbaton as week rather than Sabbath. So one of the Sabbaths becomes first day of the week. An unexplainable and unfounded change. You might think that one and first are close to the same meaning, but they are not. Consider this. If I told you I finished first in a marathon, that is a whole lot different than if I told you I was one of the finishers. Words have specific meaning. Thank God there are some English translations that correctly translated Sabbaton. The four I am aware of are the Concordant Literal New Testament, the Young's Literal Translation, the Interlinear Bible, and the Interlinear KJV-NIV Parallel New Testament in Greek and English. Now, not all interlinear Bibles are the same, but the Interlinear Bible at scripturesforall.org has the proper translation. Now, I believe the Concordant Literal New Testament has one of the best translations of the resurrection account. So let's look at the resurrection accounts from the four Gospels using this text. Remember, this is a literal translation, so the text flow is awkward at times. In Mark we read, "And very early in the morning, on one of the Sabbaths, they are coming to the tomb at the rising of the sun. And they said to themselves, Who will be rolling away the stone for us out of the door of the tomb? And looking up, they behold, and the stone has been rolled back, for it was tremendously great. And entering into the tomb, they perceived a youth sitting at the right, clothed with a white robe, and they were overawed. Now, he is saying to them, Be not overawed. Jesus, are you seeking the Nazarene, the crucified? He was roused. He is not here. Perceive the place where they place him." In Matthew we read, "Now it is the evening of the Sabbath. At the lighting up into one of the Sabbaths came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to behold the sepulchre." In Luke we read, "Now in the early depths of one of the Sabbaths, they and certain others together with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they make ready." In John we read, "Now on one of the Sabbaths, Miriam Magdalene is coming to the tomb in the morning, there being still darkness, and is observing the stone taken away from the door of the tomb." You are probably wondering how Jesus was crucified on Friday and rose on Sabbath, Saturday. It's simple. He was not crucified on Friday. Nowhere in the Bible does it say he was. But I have wondered since I was a child how he could have been crucified on Friday and be in the grave 3 days and risen on Sunday. This is also impossible. There is just no way you can get 3 days and 3 nights between Friday evening and Sunday morning. Jesus gave us very specific insight into his burial and resurrection, and the significance of these texts has been largely overlooked. Jesus stated that he would be in the grave 3 days and 3 nights, and that he would rise on the third day. In Matthew 14:40 we read, "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." In Luke 13:33 we read, "And the third day I shall be perfected." In Luke 24:33, "Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day." Luke also records in chapter 9, verse 22, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be slain, and be raised the third day." Remember, in modern timekeeping, the day starts at 12 a.m., midnight. But in the Jewish keeping of time, the day starts at sundown. The Jewish day begins with the evening. The morning starts the second half of the day, but the morning never starts a new day. Therefore, if Jesus rose on the third day, when we count the days Jesus was in the tomb, we must start with the evening. That is the only way we can get 3 evenings and 3 days. The evening began the first of the 3 days, just after Jesus was buried. The morning of the third day was the resurrection. As we continue, it is important to distinguish the difference between the two types of Sabbaths. There was and is the seventh day Sabbath, which we are commanded to keep in the fourth commandment. The seventh day Sabbath is always on the seventh day. And there are the yearly Jewish festival Sabbaths. These Sabbaths each came once per year, and they could be any day of the week, just like Christmas falls on a different day each year. So typically, during a festival week, there would be two Sabbaths, except for the rare occasion when the festival Sabbath was on the seventh day. Passover was the festival that was in progress when Jesus was crucified. This was an 8-day festival. The first day was the Passover sacrifice. The next 7 days were the days of unleavened bread. The first day and the last day of the week of unleavened bread were Sabbaths. There was no work done on those two Sabbath days. Passover commemorated Israel's delivery from Egypt. In Exodus we read, "Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel, and said unto them, Draw out and take you a lamb according to your families, and kill the Passover. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop, and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door, and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your house to smite you. And ye shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever." In Numbers 28 we see the commandment to keep the Passover, and in the 14th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord, and in the 15th day of this month is the feast. 7 days shall unleavened bread be eaten. In the first day shall be a holy convocation. Ye shall do no manner of servile work therein. Now let's look at the gospel accounts of the events beginning with the Last Supper and ending with the resurrection. At the Last Supper, Jesus and the disciples ate the Passover meal. Remember, in Bible timekeeping, a new day begins at sundown. So Passover began at sundown. The meal did not include the Passover lamb, which had not yet been killed. Mark records, "And the first day of unleavened bread, when they killed the Passover, his disciples said unto him, Where wilt thou that we go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover?" That very night, after the Passover meal, and after Jesus had prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was betrayed, arrested, and put on trial. Jesus went before the Sanhedrin, Herod, and Pontius Pilate. At the trial of Jesus, the chief priests, hypocrites as they were, did not go into the judgment hall because they didn't want to be defiled. If they were defiled, they would not have been able to eat the Passover sacrifice, which had not yet been killed. John records, "Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas unto the hall of judgment, and it was early, and they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover." At Jesus' trial, Pilate ordered the crucifixion of Jesus to satisfy the Jews. Later that very day, Jesus was crucified. Jesus was and is the Passover lamb, and he was crucified at the very hour the Passover lambs were to be sacrificed. John records, "And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour, and he saith unto the Jews, Behold your king. And they cried out, Away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, Shall I crucify your king? The chief priest answered, We have no king but Caesar. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away, and he bearing his cross went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. Jesus' body was buried in the tomb before sundown. Sundown was the beginning of the festival of unleavened bread, the first day being a Sabbath day. Luke records, And behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor, and he was a good man, and a just. The same had not consented to the council and the deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. This man went unto Pilate and begged for the body of Jesus. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in the sepulcher that was hewn in stone, wherein never man before was laid. And that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew on. The next day, the day after the crucifixion, was the first day of the week of unleavened bread. It was a Sabbath. According to Scripture, the disciples rested. That same day, Pilate had the tomb of Jesus sealed. Luke writes, And they returned and prepared spices and ointments, and rested the Sabbath day, according to the commandment. On the second day, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome went and bought spices. They then would have needed to prepare the spices. This apparently took most of the day. Scripture records in Luke 24:1 that the spices had already been prepared prior to arriving at the tomb on resurrection morning. Mark writes, And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. The preceding text is a very important text in establishing a timeline. They bought spices when the Sabbath was past, this being the Passover Sabbath, or Sabbath of unleavened bread, which was past. Jesus had already been in the tomb for more than one day when they bought the spices. Mary Magdalene lived in Bethany, which was a small village. The women likely stayed with her. It is possible they would have needed to go to Jerusalem to buy the spices and then bring them back to Bethany to prepare them. Bethany was about 2 miles from Jerusalem. The spices would have needed to be bought, prepared, and then carried the 2 miles to Jerusalem. As Scripture records, they did not take the spices to the tomb until the next morning, which was the morning of the third day. There is only one possible sequence of days that would fit the biblical timeline. This scenario would be a crucifixion on Wednesday. A Wednesday crucifixion makes Thursday the Sabbath of unleavened bread, and Friday would be both the day after the Sabbath and the day before the Sabbath. Of course, the third day, the day of the resurrection, was the seventh day Sabbath. This is the only accounting of time that perfectly matches up with all of Scripture. It perfectly accounts for every Scripture concerning the crucifixion and the resurrection. It accounts for the prophecies of Jesus being 3 days and 3 nights in the tomb. It accounts for every Scripture leading up to the crucifixion, every Scripture concerning the day of the trial and crucifixion, and every Scripture concerning the days after the crucifixion. Jesus stated in Matthew 12:8, For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. What we see now is that Jesus, the Lord of the Sabbath, was raised from the dead on the Sabbath day. As students of the Word, we are seeking deeper understanding and new light. By personal experience, I know that new light can bring a range or combination of emotions. These emotions can include excitement, contemplation, confusion, and fear. These range of emotions can result because we are not sure how this new light will affect our life or what we should do about it. As a teacher, my goal is to lead you past emotion and into a deeper, trusting relationship and a closer walk with God the Father. He is the light of God. My goal is also to lead you to a deeper dependence on the Holy Spirit of God, who will guide your life and lead you into all truth. The Holy Spirit will reveal what this new life means for your life. Does God's Word matter? Many will argue and tell you that this change is unimportant and doesn't really matter. Many of the same people will use the lie as the basis of their argument that you should ignore God's commandment regarding the Sabbath. Incredibly, this small change regarding the day of Christ's resurrection is a determining factor in convincing more than 95% of the Christian world to worship on a different day than God commands. Even more incredible, this lie is compelling more than 95% of the Christian world to break God's commandment. This is a topic that needs prayer. I invite you to pray with me. Father in heaven, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for me and pay the price for my sins. I thank you for raising him from the dead and that he is now interceding in heaven on my behalf. I thank you for preserving the Word of God for my benefit, and I thank you for revealing new truth to me today. Father, I desire to serve you and to do your will. Father, please send your Holy Spirit to fill me up to overflowing. I pray that your Holy Spirit would guide me into all truth. I pray that your Holy Spirit would convict my heart of what this new truth of the resurrection means to me. I pray that the Holy Spirit would show me any changes you want to make in my life in regards to this truth about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I pray that the Holy Spirit may strengthen me, that I may be able to do any and all you ask or desire of me. I pray this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to visit my website, americascomingjudgment.com. At my website, you can download this Bible study and many others. There are also prayers which are available for downloading. And you will also find dreams and visions of America's future from many men of God. At my website, you can also get my ebook, The Soon Coming Judgment of God Upon America and How to Escape It. This is an intensive study that uses little-known history to prove, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that the United States of America has fulfilled every description of Babylon in the Book of Revelation. It took over 10,000 hours to research and write this book, and thousands of more hours in prayer. This ebook is provided on a donation basis and requires a donation of any amount. You determine the amount. I simply guarantee this is one of the most important books you have ever read, or your money back. Since I began selling this book in 2006, it has been read by pastors, doctors, lawyers, hedge fund managers, businessmen, and people like you. And as of this date, I have a 100% satisfaction rate.